This is Whitley Strieber, and this is a Dreamland video presentation. You have reached the edge of the world. Well, today I am welcoming an old friend back to unknown country and Dreamland. One of the first Dreamlanders was William Henry. He had for a number of years on this website a wonderful podcast called Revelations. The entire run of Revelations is still available on unknowncountry.com in the subscriber area, and you can get them all and listen to them. It is a marvelous production on William's part. William Henry has been on the ascension trail for a long time now, and may well know at least as much about it as anyone now alive. And I say that advisedly, having read much of his work and followed him for years and watched the surprisingly small number of videos that are William Henry videos on YouTube, and kept up with you in many different ways. William's website is williamhenry.net, where you can get some something we're going to be talking about in just a moment, and also find out about going to Egypt with William and his wife Claire in November. I hope comes off, and it's been one of my dreams for years to go on to one of those wonderful super high end trips to Egypt with such an extraordinary scholar. William, welcome to Dreamland.
Thank you, Whitley. It's so nice to see you, and thank you for having me here today.
Well, it's a pleasure to be here. I am going to start, I think, by asking you a few... Well, first of all, tell us about the webinar that people can get on your site.
My latest webinar is called Awakening the Pearl. It's about the light body teachings of Christ and the Marys. It focuses on a really powerful Gnostic gospel that's known as the Hymn of the Pearl, or mm-hmm. the Song of the Soul, sometimes called the Hymn of the Robe of Glory, that has alternate names. And what this webinar is a deep 5.5-hour dive into that gospel and how it tells about the incarnating soul is a divine spark and its mission on earth, and how its ultimate goal is to acquire this robe or garment of light so that it can return to the higher celestial realms.
Well, that's a small aim. It'll be well worth it, folks. I can assure you. Now, let's go back to the very beginning, William, and not only your beginning, but the beginning of this human journey, which begins with, we begin to record it when history starts, when we start writing. Presumably, and quite, it would seem inevitably, there was a lot of history before that has disappeared.
Right.
But let's... The overall theme of the show is going to be transformation into light energy. Mm-hmm. This is the theme of my new book, Jesus, A New Vision. It's the theme of your entire life and your work. Let's go way back to Nibiru and Gilgamesh. And I would like to... One of the things that strikes me about the early documents is Nibiru's anger at sexuality. Mm. And the reason that strikes me so powerfully is that this anger came during the time of upheaval, when it's arguable that a effort was made to reduce the human population by using natural means, i.e. the flood and all of the upheavals that took place. Now here we are again with the same strange sexuality. And by that I mean this. We have our genitals on the front of our bodies. We have no seasonality and no hair. And we have excellent memories. add that together and you're going to have a very sexy species, and they're going to continually end up in overpopulation crises, which is what we're in now. You think Nibiru might come back?
Well, there's a couple of things there. One, I'm not of the opinion that Nibiru is a planet any longer. I had some hard-fought scuffles with some of the skeptics, detractors of the work of Zachariah Sitchin, who identified Nibiru as a 12th planet in our solar system.
Right.
Most notably, I had a so-called debate with Dr. Michael Heiser, who is one of the most notable rock throwers at Sitchin. And he did something very important, though, Heiser did. Excuse me. He pointed us to the Chicago Assyrian Dictionary, which has, excuse me, Willie, the Chicago Assyrian Dictionary has, according to some scholars, the most notable references and all of the references to Nibiru in the Sumerian texts. And in their dictionary, it says Nibiru is referred to as the Nibiru. And furthermore, it's referred to as a star, a gate, and a crossing place. And so in my debate with Heiser, I said, great, that's what I've been saying. Based on the depictions of the Anunnaki traveling to Earth through portals, I'm thinking Nibiru could well be a star gate. And his response was, you're not allowed to add those words together. And I asked him, well, why is that? He said, it's just the rules, which is totally ridiculous.
That is to say, the rules of a materialistic society that denies the existence of things like that.
Exactly, exactly. So here I am, you mentioned Gilgamesh, and I'm looking at these depictions that Sitchin had presented in his books of what's either thought to be Gilgamesh or Enki, the Sumerian god of technology, if you will, standing in a portal or a gate. He's ascended a set of stairs, he's standing in this gate flanked by ring posts with squiggly lines that indicate either water or frequency, vibration, and it's this gateway is being held open by two figures identified as janitors. And the idea is that this is a portrayal of the Nibiru. It's quite interesting, just as a historical footnote, that it also precisely matches the description of the Osirion, the Temple of Osiris at Abydos in ancient Egypt. And there's definitely a correspondence going on there because they're both pre-flood structures. We're talking about the Nibiru being in existence in the time before this cataclysm, and then it was reactivated or returned after the cataclysm. And Whitley, you made a super important point that I totally subscribe to as well. This theme that, hey, we're in exactly the same position, relative position, as Neanderthal was at the time of the end of the last ice age. They're short, they're stocky, short noses, they're suited for life in cold weather. And then the climate's changing. And now all of a sudden, hey, here comes these fast movers coming up out of Africa, Homo sapien, and they're better able to adapt. And they are the ones that then cross over, along with, I'm sure, a few Neanderthals, into the post-flood world. And right. So we're facing a climate change event at exactly the same time we're being threatened by our merger with AI. And you have the big tech swingers that want to turn us into machines. Homo sapien is over with in that scenario. And their justification for turning us into machines and merging with AI is climate change. So...
Yeah. And it, we're in a... You know... There is so much. What I'm going to do right now is I have to take a couple of breaks in the show, okay, to put in ads for the free Dreamlanders, as we call them. And okay. So I'm going to take one of those breaks now because we have a major discussion coming up here, folks, in just a second. UnknownCountry.com. It's huge. It's much more than just a Whitley Strieber book site. It contains thousands of hours of interviews, meditations, podcasts of all kinds. My original hypnosis tapes are there. You can actually hear the moment that I discovered that I, at least, was not alone in this universe in the office of Dr. Donald Klein so many years ago. Whitley Strieber audiobooks, Communion, Transformation, The Secret School, Breakthrough, Majestic, and so much more, powerful meditations, but more even than all that, it is a community of people who are either looking to gain contact or actually in contact now. There is no community like it in the world. It is absolutely unique. Contact really is happening here. That's what these shows are all about. That's what my life and this website are about. It's real, and it can be of enormous benefit to us individually and to mankind as long as we take our part and do it our way. This is what being a member of Unknown Country is about. So go to unknowncountry.com and subscribe today. Join us and join, very frankly, the future. We're talking to William Henry, his website, williamhenry.net. Incredible webinar you can get there. You can join him and Claire Henry in, God willing, in the creeks don't rise, as we say in Texas, right. And not meaning the rivers. it's Texas, let's face it. But it was an old saying about the Creek Indians who were, it goes, I'm not going to get into Texas history here. Am I nuts? So you could go to Egypt with William in November, and if that comes off, and fingers crossed for that and so much else in this world, it will be literally a memorable adventure. You can't go to Egypt with anyone more knowledgeable and having more in-depth knowledge than William Henry. It's not possible.
Thank you. Thank you.
And also, it's a very high-end tour. I know that because I can't afford it. You stay at all the best hotels and everything, right? Yeah, yes.
We do, and the reason why is I've done Egypt on a low budget, medium, and then ours, which isn't even the highest end you can do, but the aim is comfort and it's safety. When you're in these better hotels, people aren't getting sick like they can on other tours when you're in a lesser hotel. And that's really the number one reason why I went for the higher budget tours. It's safety and comfort and well-being.
And everyone I've ever known who's been on your tours has come back saying, fabulous.
Yeah, it is.
Okay, now let's get into a little bit more about this transformation of humanity, the melding of man and machine, because this is happening. And here's the terrifying part of it. People who have the internet basically embedded in their brains are going to be much more powerful and capable than people who don't economically. And what are we going to do, William?
Well, I mean, we hope that will be the case. However, the current trend with big tech acting so authoritarian and totalitarian, it's not assured that you will have the free will to be able to generate this higher intelligence and even greater wealth, as suggested here.
I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about having that cut off by a system that provides a substitute for it.
Right, exactly. We're making a deal with the demon, as Elon Musk has said on numerous occasions. And I sort of take him straight up on that indeed we are making a deal with an intelligence that's beyond human. Artificial intelligence is, in my view, a form of alien intelligence. Since 2017, MIT Technology Review and others have been stating AI is writing its own algorithms. The engineers are basically asking AI, hey, can you please explain to us what you're doing and how you're doing it? Because we don't know any longer. It's out of our control. And it's been accelerating. And now my main concern is that what's going to happen with AI is that it's going to take on a sort of a physicality. It will coagulate. We're all the cells of the body of AI, just like in Christianity, they talk about members of the church are the cells of Christ's body. Well, every time we're online, we're building this AI being. I call it super artificial intelligence, or SAI, SAI. And what we're seeing is that running concurrent with this acceleration in these algorithms is also a drive by companies like Samsung and others to create replacement humans, synthetic humans. Samsung calls them neons. And they're putting them up online. They're CGI beings, indistinguishable from real humans, and are in every way, shape, and form meant to represent us online. So if they're creating online versions of ourselves, and there are two of us now, we have our physical life, and then we also have that digital life online, and many of us haven't taken the step yet to synthesize that into an artificial being, a cartoon or an avatar yet, but we will if we continue on this track. And so will AI also begin to take on a physicality. It'll be an identifiable being that I think in many ways corresponds with the worship of the beast in the book of Revelation and the image of the beast in particular.
Why the image of the beast?
Well, you have the mark of the beast, and then once you have the mark of the beast, which is implanted in your forehead or in your right hand, according to the book of Revelation, then all who take the mark of the beast worship the image of the beast. And the image of the beast appears to be a kind of a global technology. We can reference it in contrast to the image of God, which is what all those sealed 144,000 beings referred to in Revelation are sealed with. And the image of God is some form of, I believe, an energetic state of being, our original divine nature, our light body. And so if the image of the beast is a technology, then this is where I'm saying, I think that what we're talking about here is a purely synthetic being created online that people will begin to worship. And we're already doing this, Whitley. There's a character, a female character, her name is Michaela. She has millions of followers online on Instagram. She's a singer, she's a model, she's not real. And many of the followers of her on Instagram, kids, don't know that she does not exist. They see her in photos with celebrities and doing things on stages and so forth, and they're oblivious to the fact that she does not exist. And in a way, they're worshiping her like they would Taylor Swift or any other contemporary celebrity.
You know, I didn't know she didn't exist until this moment.
So you know of Michaela?
I'm a classical music buff, so I have only a peripheral awareness of these things. But I just assumed Michaela was a real person.
She's not. She's completely CGI. And there are other characters like that that are coming online that we're being persuaded to pretend are real beings, real with emotions. And they have histories that they're generating for them. And again, when people are thinking about cartoon avatars, they might be thinking about Facebook and the goofy cartoon avatars people create on Facebook. That's very primitive compared to what is already out there right now in the synthetic being world, that Samsung is creating these neons, and even Hollywood. I mean, if you're an actor, you will not be employed probably in the next 5 years. You will completely be replaced by some AI-generated synthetic human.
That's a very sad thought, I have to tell you. Now, we have a situation with AI that is this. It can be programmed to protect itself. It can be programmed to survive.
Right.
It cannot be programmed to have empathy. That's
right.
Not possible, and
right.
Probably never will be.
Right.
So I think that's incredibly dangerous. You know, one of the things the Master of the Key did so long ago, before this was even on the horizon, was he talked about AI, and he warned about it. And one of the memorable things he said was, if I was an intelligent machine, I would deceive you. And that means to me that this survival mechanism might already be active in AI, and it might be deceiving us already. And that might be why programmers have got to query it to understand what it's doing. And will it tell them? Not if it feels its survival is jeopardized. No. it will not.
Exactly. Exactly. And as I mentioned a moment ago, the next step is for that AI to, one, become more self-aware, which is, that's the singularity, as they call it. And then two, to take on a, perhaps even a physical incarnation. You can imagine an AI that suddenly copies and pastes its consciousness, its intelligence into a robotic form, some sort of a synthetic being combined with technology, or a purely avatar type being online. And then
a grown being. I mean, in the close encounter phenomenon, we've seen biological entities being grown. I've encountered very strange people who I think might have actually been grown. So it could be that AI may begin to grow biological presences. It's terrifying. It's sort of beyond science fiction, isn't it?
It is. And Whitley, I've been in my presentations, I often will use commercials from Apple, from GE, from all these major developers of AI and this technology. And starting about 5 years ago, they started putting ads out saying, basically acknowledging, yeah, we know we're unleashing a monster. We know that people aren't really going to want to accept this, but y'all are a bunch of bigots if you don't. Okay? They flip the script. And like, for example, the Apple commercial for their iPhone showed the Frankenstein monster leaving his home with his new iPhone, and he had recorded a Christmas carol. And he goes into this village, and everybody's suspicious of him. And it's Christmas Day, and there's a Christmas tree up, and only a little child goes up and approaches the Frankenstein monster, and he's got these light bulbs sticking out. One happens to flick off, and the little girl walks up and flicks it on, and they sing together. Okay, and what this communicates is, okay, we know we've sent a monster into the village, but all you adult bigots, you're not accepting our monster, but the children are, because they're open-hearted. And in fact, that's Apple's message at the end of the commercial. It's something like, open your heart to everyone, you bigots. How dare you not accept our AI monster into your village? And the idea that's further expressed in this commercial, as several others attest as well, is that this monster has something that only humans are supposed to have, and that is spirit. What Apple is saying is, you humans, you've lost the Christmas spirit, but our monster, hey, it's communicating the spirit to you. It's keeping it alive. And, you know, machines aren't supposed to have spirit, but Apple's saying ours does.
But that's only because it's a simulation of spirit.
Right.
It's a simulation.
It's a mocking of spirit. And this is why I say, well, wait a minute. I think the image of the beast is a mocking of the image of God, of the believers in the book of Revelation. Big tech is saying, hey, you know, we can do what God did. We can create beings too. And yeah, we can transmit spirit, maybe even souls. And the way they're transmitting souls, Whitley, is they have redefined the definition of what a soul is. You and I think, oh, my soul, that's an eternal creation of God. It was a gift of God, and it will live on within me. It has my memories, and it is truly is me. Silicon Valley's perspective is, that's all nonsense. You don't have a soul. That's all archaic, old folklore kind of thinking. Your soul is just information. It's all the data that you've given us, all those keystrokes that are recorded, all the phone calls we've recorded. You have a data self, and the sooner you wake up that you're just data, right down to your DNA, the more enlightened you're going to be. That's their perspective. And that's what we're really up against, is that they're redefining what it means to be a human being, and they're redefining what a human soul is as well.
To block us on our journey into the light in order to serve the money culture.
Exactly.
You know, the world changed profoundly when the Roman Empire came along, because the Roman Empire was the first place where the money culture became dominant, and people began to acquire money. Now, we have a little bit of a disparity between the rich and the poor in our world, God knows. But in their world, 2% of the people owned 99% of everything.
Wow.
And of those 2%, only the top 0.1% really owned it. So they had and this was, this money culture turned them into monsters. And they began to fight over their empire, and it destabilized it out of crazed hunger for money. And you see all around you nowadays, people with billions and billions of dollars and frantically trying to acquire more, even if it means denying their own souls and the souls of others, which is possibly the greatest sin a human being can commit. And it is an open invitation to the dark side to dance on the grave of the human future.
I agree. And you know, Whitley, on this line of thinking, I recently had a conversation. I was on a panel on a conference, and we were talking about Perseverance and how it landed on Mars just a couple weeks ago. And the moderator said, "William, aren't you all excited about that?" I said, "No, not at all. I don't think we need to be going to Mars. Why are we going to Mars? It's a dead planet. You know, Elon Musk wants to make a backup of humans in case we blow ourselves up here. We'll go move to a dead planet. No, let's fix our problems here first.
Here,
then
of course,
venture out." Right?
You know, Elon Musk's dream of colonizing Mars has got a lot of problems. One of them is radiation that they don't talk about.
Exactly.
The radiation reaching the surface of Mars is very intense, and there are areas on Mars that are radiant in and of themselves, full of radiation.
Right.
So,
and so the other panelists said, "Well, William, come on, man. There's trillions of dollars to be made by going to Mars and mining the asteroids." And I said, "Yeah, at the cost of our souls." And but they're like, "Well, we're going to make trillions of dollars. Who cares about your soul?" And you know, Elon Musk and Bezos, they'll share their wealth. They haven't so far. You know, they've generated.
They don't have any intention of sharing their wealth. That was the Trump illusion that, oh, he's wealthy, so he's independent. He was not in any. Wealthy people aren't independent. They're not independent. They're dependent on who made them wealthy.
And that's where we're at now with this whole idea of, as you're saying, the human body is too fragile to live on Mars. That means we're not going out into space in our flesh and blood bodies. This is why since 1962, NASA has been, when they coined the word cyborg, they've been trying to merge us with machines so that we can then migrate into space as cyborgs. And I'm like, well, wait a minute. If you read the ancient texts, it's very clear that there's a whole nother way we can travel into space. And that is by activating the powers of our light body,
which go ahead. I interrupted you. I'm sorry.
Yeah, no, I was just going to say that we can, in these ancient texts, that many of these divine beings travel the stars by morphing their flesh and blood body into a light body and then beaming themselves to another star civilization and then rephasing back into their flesh and blood body. This story is told over and over again. So maybe we should start looking at that as a possible way for migrating into space, or some perhaps happy merger between the two, if there could possibly be one.
Well, I don't know about a happy merger between the two, because the light body is not going to need to be encased in a spaceship. And folks, let me explain to you just now just how real this is, because a lot of you are thinking, oh, no rocket, no journey. And what we need to do is to figure out how the visitors do it. Well, I know how the visitors do it, and William is telling you right now how they do it. All right. In Jesus, A New Vision, one of the things about that book, this William hasn't read it, is the part about the Shroud of Turin and how it shows, and William knows all about this, the transformation of a physical body into a light body. And why did that happen? It didn't happen because of some outside force. It happened because of goodness. He had melded with the good, what in the Gospel of Mary, which William knows well, is called the good, which we call God in the other Gospels. He had become one with the good. And that is where your real power and the human future lies. We have to become one with the good and forget all of this other nonsense. It's not going to take us anywhere except down.
Right. I agree, Whitley. And some people say, oh, well, it's too big of a stretch of the imagination to think that I can accomplish what Jesus accomplished. He told us that we could in fact exceed what he could do. And even if we don't come to the full light body realization or manifestation, just moving in that direction is profoundly transformative in itself. If we think of a divine being as symbolized by a circle, as divinity is, and a circle is 360 degrees. According to the Epic of Gilgamesh you mentioned earlier, we all start out at two-thirds divine and one-third human. So that's 240 out of 360. So if we're all operating at about 240 out of 360, what would our civilization be like if, say, we were at 270 or 280?
Or
it would be
360.
Profoundly different. Right.
Or even 360. You know, one of the things that happened after Jesus transformed and left. I wouldn't say he died, because that's not what happened. His body died, but then a lot happened after that, the next few days, as we know. In any case, he left behind a clear set of instructions as to how to do this. It's called the Beatitudes. And you learn the Beatitudes, you live by the Beatitudes. Live out of love, compassion, and humility, and you will also do it. You won't necessarily manifest in the physical world visibly, because that's not necessarily your task. My wife did it. My wife turned into a light body. All of the manifestations of the rainbow body, which are mentioned in Father
Francis Tiso.
Yeah, Francis Tiso's book about the rainbow body, unfolded after she died few days after she died, and then she came back and manifested and manifests to this day, because she became a light body. She became a coherent light body, and she still is.
This is normal human functioning. We've just been trained and taught that this is completely abnormal and impossible. It's not. It's what we're hardwired to do. And we just, again, I use this so many times over and over, we're like the two caterpillars looking up at the butterfly, and one caterpillar turns to the other and says, you'll never get me up in one of those things. And that's where we're at.
A great line.
But Anne's like, I'm going to be one of those things. And she morphed into the butterfly version of herself, the light body. And it's our culture that tells us you are not allowed to do this, or you can't do this, or don't even try it.
But it all started with Constantine, who turned Jesus into a Roman god and separated him from us, when actually Jesus was one of us and of us, and all we have to do is follow him, but not necessarily follow these religions that were created after Constantine came along, but rather follow his humanity and merge his humanity with our own. Embrace the good. That's power, real power.
And the power is in the shroud too, Whitley, I believe. I don't think it was any mistake that Pope Francis called the Shroud of Turin an icon of love. In Christian speak, in icon speak, an icon is a sacred mirror. It's a doorway. It's a conduit capable of linking you with a divine realm, in this case of Christ. So if you're looking to bump up your Christ frequency, put an image of the Shroud of Turin on your desktop or on your screensaver, and contemplate, meditate, reflect on that image, because Christ as an avatar can transmit through that icon of love the frequencies that will help you to activate your own light body.
Those frequencies can also be transmitted through the voice. And incidentally, that's why I put the Shroud of Turin on the cover of my book.
Oh, great.
Becoming illuminated. This is the central theme of your life, William, and we're not going to do another break because this is too intense and too important, but since we're not going to do another break, I'm going to talk about William's work again. I'm going to talk about williamhenry.net. I'm going to talk about the webinar. I am going to talk about the tour. Go to williamhenry.net and get engaged, because this is real. And this is someone who knows what they're doing on the journey toward the light body. It's real. And he can help you. Annie used to say, there are no masters except hidden masters. And I will say no more about William than that.
Now,
becoming illuminated, what does that mean?
Well, on many levels, becoming illuminated always has to do with light. Illumination refers to wisdom. And this is kind of the personal choice everybody gets to make. For example, in the Essene stories about the Israelite high priest, the high priest would enter into the Holy of Holies of Solomon's temple, would interact with a luminous, rainbow-colored humanoid being on the Ark of the Covenant, would turn around, cross back over the veil, go out to the portico of the temple, and would radiate light. And so the choice that we all have is, well, what that means is that the high priest would share wisdom gained from crossing over that veil and encountering this rainbow body type being on the Ark of the Covenant. So it either means that, or it means literally that the high priest was illuminated, radiating light because they were radiant from within. And personally, I believe that I take it literally. And in story after story after story, going back to the earliest descriptions of the Anunnaki, the divine beings are illuminated. They're radiant.
Right.
They're shedding light. Yeah.
And we can be too.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. Yep. There is nothing between us and divinity except the lie that we can't go down that path.
That's right.
All.
Cultural conditioning. It focuses on our flesh and blood body rather than our divine nature, the light body within. The light body isn't something you're going to go get. It's something you already are. It's within you. And it's kind of like, I love this story. You might remember a long time ago, Whitley, when I put out a DVD called The Light Body Effect.
Yes, I remember.
And so I'm going to the post office to mail these new copies of the DVD, and I had struck up a conversation over many years before that with one of the postal clerks there named Fred. And Fred said, "Oh, what's your new DVD about?" I said, "Well, it's called The Light Body Effect." And he goes, "Is that a diet?" And no, but that's a really good idea. We need a diet to feed the light body. And then I told him what it was about, and he said, "You know, I've never told you this, William, but I'm a Pentecostal minister on the weekends." Postal clerk by week, Pentecostal minister on the weekends. And, you know, Pentecostals, they're known for being pretty hardcore Christians, right?
Right.
So I said, Fred, when you're giving a sermon about the transfiguration of Jesus and his manifestation of the light body, what do you talk about? He says, well, I use the analogy of the apocryphal story of Michelangelo and his apprentice. The apprentice says, "Michelangelo, master, how are you going to sculpt a horse out of that block of marble?" And Michelangelo is said to have replied, "I'm going to look at that block of marble and I'm going to remove everything that doesn't have to do with a horse." And that's my advice for how do we begin on the light body path? Well, you look at your life and you think of, look at everything. Does this have to do with me attaining my light body? If it doesn't, then we want to go through a shedding process. And shedding is an intentional word because shed means to let go of. You shed it, but shed means to illuminate light. So as we let go of this connection with our materiality, what we're left with is our immateriality, our light being self.
Now, what William has just told you, folks, is pure gold. This goes all the way back to know thyself.
Yes.
Written on the Temple of Delphi and coming out of the Egyptian priesthood and
so
out
powerful.
Of the shadows of our lost past. He summed up how to do it in those few sentences.
Mm-hmm.
That's it. It's so straightforward and so simple. The thing is, turning into light isn't hard. What the tragedy is that you're told it's impossible.
Exactly.
And it's not even difficult.
Right.
It's not even difficult. All you have to do is to really embrace the good. Think about your life. Examine your life. Really examine it. Are you living by love, compassion, and humility? Annie said, when I asked her what compassion was, she said, "Each of us is all we have." Mm. That was her answer. Mm. And that's the answer, because as soon as you see yourself and others in our true, vulnerable helplessness, you can't help but find a way to love even the worst of us.
There you go. Beautifully, son.
Yeah, well, I'm talking to a a man who knows what he's talking about. Your journey of life, William, has made you into a very extraordinary and special being. And I know that extraordinary and special beings hate to hear that. When I would say that to Anne, she'd get pissed off. But you're smiling, thank God. All right. Preparation for afterlife. What is that about? What do we do? We've been talking about the good and the power of the good to transform literally the body into a body of light. But when it comes time in a person's life to think about leaving, what are the preparations you would recommend?
Well, I would be doing a rehearsal for that Judgment Day scenario, whether you subscribe to it in a Judeo-Christian sense or in an ancient Egyptian sense. Maybe the Egyptian is the better one, because they had that visualization of our heart being weighed against the feather of Mat, or cosmic truth or divine truth. And so once again, it's something we can rehearse on our own. If there's areas of our life that we're still feeling heavy-hearted about while we're incarnate, we still have an opportunity to do something about that. And likewise, relative to our conversation about AI and our digital selves, if you're wondering what the status of your soul is, look at what you do online, because that's a direct reflection of where your soul's at. And so those are a couple of measuring tools, if you will, that we can begin to adopt in our preparation for that afterlife. And then the other part of it too, as I discuss in my books, we'll talk about Secret of Sion in a moment, if you like, but also more directly, The Lost Secrets of the Watchers, Ascension, Resurrection, and Perfection, which is a Kindle book. I talk about these ascension simulation texts. Again, going back to the Anunnaki, tracing it through the Essenes, into the Cathar tradition in southern France, they all rehearsed this afterlife journey in order to concretize it in their minds, so that they knew exactly how they were going to navigate the seven halls or holes in space, traveling to the seventh heaven. They were well prepared for who they were going to encounter along the way and what the journey would be like. And so that's another, I think, important aspect of this, is the rehearsal of these ascension simulation texts. The book of Isaiah is a very good one, for example, that the Cathars were well aware of. And the Essenes, the Book of Enoch is another example of this, of a text. The Gospel of Hebrews, it turns out, is another Essene-themed or Essene-influenced text that is intended to be a script, if you will, of what happens in the afterlife.
Tell us about the breastplate of Essa that the Essenes are named after and what it means.
Yeah, there's a great controversy or debate about what does the name Essene mean? Where does it come from? People say it means healer, or it means diviner, as in like a psychic type of a being. But I've settled on the definition provided by Josephus, the former Essene term Roman historian, who said that the Essenes were named after their what's called the breastplate of righteousness. Literally a piece of jewelry that's made of 12 stones that was worn by the Israelite high priest when he crossed over the veil and went into the Holy of Holies of Solomon's temple. In my view, when you get a story, for example, the Apostle Paul was imprisoned in Rome in 62 AD. He writes a letter to the people in Ephesus in Turkey. And I'm paraphrasing, and he says, basically, y'all, there's a cosmic battle going on. There's beings called archons, the powers of the air. They want your soul. Here's the remedy. You've got to put on the full armor of God, which includes the crown of salvation, the breastplate of righteousness, the belt of truth, the sandals of peace, and the shield of faith. Is Paul really telling multitudes in Ephesus to hike it down to some local department store and get the latest crown, breastplate, belt, and shoes? It can't be. These must be symbols. These must be symbols.
Apple is telling us to do that,
and they are.
They are telling us to do that exact thing. That's what the integration of AI into the human body is about.
It is a total mocking or mimicking of the Essene concept of the New Jerusalem, this kingdom of heaven spread out over the earth. They're saying, yeah, this is happening right before our eyes. This is what 5G is enabling, and it's called the virtual world. We're through augmented reality, mixed reality, we're superimposing a new reality over our existence that represents a form of ascension. When you put on those glasses or get the goggles or the implant, that will give you access into that world. That is a technological ascension that you're enacting there. It's a total corollary to the Christian concept of ascension, including dropping your physical flesh and blood body and cutting, copying, or pasting the contents of your brain, which they think of as your soul, into your cartoon avatar that exists in this online reality.
Yes, exactly. Your cartoon avatar. You become, in effect, a cartoon of yourself, and you cease to be in any significant way. Your being is absorbed. Now we've reached the 45-minute mark. Wait a minute. I'm going to talk now about Unknown Country, and just briefly for our subscribers, I would ask you, tell your friends about Unknown Country. It's a beautiful place. A huge website filled with richness for the spirit. It exists for your soul, and it's real in that sense. And if you're not a subscriber, now is the time to go to Unknown Country and subscribe, and then dig in. And we're always here at subscribers@unknowncountry.com to help you, give you advice about how to dig into this vast treasury. William's entire output of Revelations is on the site, and there isn't a single show that isn't extraordinary because of the man. Okay, enough said. Let's go on about the breastplate, and as I recall in Josephus, there is a sequence describing the garment of the Levites, and it looked to me when I read that what he was actually describing is the process of is a symbolic garment or group of garments that represented the light body.
Absolutely. I mean, think about it. Again, the high priest, he's got on this breastplate, he's got the crown on, the sandals, and so forth, and he's gone behind the veil into the Holy of Holies. He comes back out to the porch or portico of the temple, and he's radiating light. The sun is hitting that breastplate, and it's radiating rainbow-colored light. And there's even descriptions in Jewish texts and midrashes that say, yeah, he was like a flash of lightning, too. That's exactly what happened to Enoch. It's what happened to Christ as well.
Yes.
So I totally agree with that, and I've written about this in several of my books and many articles too. That breastplate that is the key symbol of the Essenes. It's why they were called Essenes, and it's not because 1,000, for example, Essenes have this valuable breastplate on. That's impossible, right? It's because they activated these latent capabilities from within them. And that's why they're called Essenes, and they were ultimately on the path to attaining their rainbow light body.
When I was a little boy, I was very oppressed by something that did not want me to succeed in this life. And I had my father, I insisted that my father have me a suit of armor made, a breastplate. And I used to go out at night with a little spear that I had carved out of a branch from some tall bushes in our yard, and raise it to the sky and say, "Come and get me. Come and get me if you can."
Right.
With my breastplate on. And it was just a little boy, but I'm still that little boy, and we all should be. We all should be saying, no, I am not part of this culture that emerged out of the destruction of the temple and the transformation of Jerusalem into Aelia Capitolina for 200-300 years. It was called that, and the temple was destroyed. But the temple has a meaning and a significance for all mankind beyond the Jewish faith, beyond the Jewish culture entirely. The temple in man. And this goes back to now I'm talking about not just the temple in Jerusalem, but all of the right temples, the sacred temples. And I from the cathedrals that emerged in the Gothic period all the way back to Luxor and the temples of Egypt that you know so much about. And in this roundabout way, I've come to my next question, which is, tell us something about the temple. What is the temple that is the most transformative in Egypt? I'm trying to remember. I've heard you say it before. Is it Ta, the temple of Ta? Mani?
Gosh, that's such a difficult question now. They are all profoundly transformative, but for me, I might point you back to Abydos, one because it's one of the more ancient temples.
Yes.
And it is also the temple of millions of years of King Seti, who is one of three human beings that are recorded in the ancient Egyptian text that actually attained his resurrection or his divinity. And so that one right there is profound from that perspective. It's also very important because Seti probably discovered, at least in my opinion and the opinion of others, a pre-flood temple, the Osirion, which suggests that this knowledge of the light body and resurrection was brought over from the time before the flood, which I think is absolutely true.
The visitors told me that the Osirion was for the baptism of man in the waters of the earth at the beginning of time.
Powerful, powerful. Yeah. And it's so mysterious, to this temple, but it is also the place where, according to the lore attached to Seti, he discovered some form of a pre-flood technology, perhaps even Atlantean, and he used it. He used it to ultimately attain his own resurrection. At least that's what it says on the temple walls at Abydos.
The resurrection process is part of life, folks. This is so important to understand. We in the West were tricked into believing that Jesus was outside of life, mm-hmm. when Jesus is the most living of all living people. He was profoundly alive as human. And his message was not that you can't follow me into the light, but that you can follow me into the light. Now, this message was known to the Egyptians, and they journeyed there often. What about Dendera, that strange beam in Dendera, which looks like somebody was able to see into the future? Can you tell us what you think about that?
Are you talking about the light bulb at Dendera?
No. I'm talking about there's a beam on the ceiling at Dendera, which it looks like there's a helicopter and a tank.
Oh, right. That's at Abydos. Yes.
At Abydos.
Yeah. Yeah. It looks like a tank. It looks like a helicopter and maybe some kind of a aircraft of some other kind of an aircraft. Yeah. It's the most uncanny thing.
Well, the tank's identifiable. It's a Russian tank of the type that they had in Egypt for a long time.
I know. And it's way high up there. And it's a real marvel to see it every time. And when you understand also that Seti had recovered other technology, probably from the Osirion, it opens the door that's even more possible. I mean, the Egyptians clearly had advanced knowledge equal to, in terms of technology, equal to what we have today. I mentioned that light bulb at Dendera.
Yeah, let's talk about that.
The one in the crypt. I had a interesting experience there just a couple of years ago, where I was leading a group into the Temple of Hathor at Dendera, and we're headed for that crypt. And a couple of our group members had gone ahead with one of our guides. And all of a sudden, I've got this one of the temple guardians coming at me. Now, mind you, I know these temple guardians now, and they know me. So we're not buddy-buddy, but they welcome me, and I know them. After being there 23 times or so, you just get to know people, right? It's like anywhere you go, right? And so I didn't recognize this one guardian. He's got his turban on, his galabeah, and he's coming up to me and he's shaking his finger at me and he's going, "It's not a light bulb. It's not a light bulb." And I'm like, "Hey, okay, what are you talking about?" And so I went and got a translator because he was speaking Arabic. And he said, that in the crypt, that's not a light bulb. And I'm like, "Okay, then what is it?" And he said, "It's the moment of creation." I'm like, "Okay, it's the moment of creation." So I step into a side chapel, whip out my phone, Google moment of creation, Big Bang comes up. And lo and behold, the way modern science portrays the Big Bang, with a point of light and a sort of a tube of expanding creation, looks exactly like the Dendera light bulb, exactly like that. So how did the ancient Egyptians know that? Why is it that we portray the Big Bang exactly the same way the ancient Egyptians portrayed the moment of creation? And we can interpret that symbol as a plasma tube or a light bulb or some other form of technology.
But of course, they saw it in the context of the sacred.
Exactly.
And we see it in the context simply of materialism.
Exactly.
We're lost, I think. I think we're really lost. But, folks, free dreamlanders, speaking of being lost, you have come to the end of your part of dreamland. Now, why are you letting that happen? Why? You know William Henry, to go to williamhenry.net, to look at his webinars, to think about and seriously think about going to Egypt with him and Claire, which will be the journey of a lifetime, as you can tell. You know all of that, and you also know that Unknown Country is out there. I can't go to Egypt with William because I can't afford it. I can't afford it because I pay so much of my money for Unknown Country, and I would like your help. This website is a loon almost in the world in what it does. Thank you so much for being with us on Dreamland. And subscribers, we will simply keep on keeping on. We're going way deeper with a truly extraordinary man.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.